Are you sick of being lied to?
Do you think that you're getting the whole picture?
There's always another side to every story.
Are you ready to see something different?
Like you've never experienced before.
Truth.
Integrity.
Health.
The nature of reality.
Transparency.
Empowering information.
New ways of looking at the world.
Music, news, alternative views.
Going where the mainstream dare not go.
Your voice has been silenced for far too long.
What have you got to say?
The world needs to change.
The world is truly of our own making.
People are waking up.
It's time to take your power back.
The time is now.
It's time for a new voice.
It's up to you.
We want you to be part of it.
We can do this.
Join us.
The People's Voice.
Response to our first show yesterday. We want to build on that and make Sonia Poulton Live more interactive, more global, and we invite you to get involved by phoning us towards the end of the show on 0203 714 2700 if you are calling from outside of the UK. And we really want you to remember to add 44 and drop the first zero. And again, thank you. The feedback has been phenomenal. We love it. We want to know where we're getting it right. We want to know where, in your opinion, we're getting it wrong. So tell us, please, get involved, get interactive. Thank you. Now, my first thought for today on November the 26th, 2013 is yesterday I spoke with Prime Ministerial aide Alan Senderek. Now, through him, I invited the Prime Minister, David Cameron, onto the People's Voice to discuss, among other things, the impact of the Welfare Reform Act and the dire consequences of our NHS and the Health and Social Care Bill. I explained on the phone and then in a subsequent email that I am actually an outspoken critic of the government's austerity drive, and I welcomed an opportunity to put these criticisms I have to the Prime Minister of England in person. Alas, it was not to be. Today, I received this curt email. Let me read it to you. It says, Sonia, not hi, not hello, not even a comma after the Sonia. Sonia, many thanks for your invitation to the Prime Minister to appear on the People's Voice TV. This is not an opportunity we will be taking up at this moment in time. So, David Cameron, our Prime Minister, is not prepared to engage with the People's Voice, even though we are representing the people. It's extraordinary that the PM has shown such blatant indifference to engaging with TPV. Perhaps he needs to be reminded who the bosses are when it comes to his career. And it's us, the people. So just bear that in mind. Now, today I am pleased to say I'm joined by an outspoken barrister, author and intelligence advisor, Michael Shrimpton. The fact that he is still serving at the bar is a considerable surprise to those who are familiar with his views. Pulling no punches, Mr. Shrimpton claims to know a multitude of establishment secrets, not all I agree with him on, but he's unafraid to share them, thankfully. So I welcome him today.
You're not going to see them implicated in Operation Yew Trees, are you? Operation Yew Tree is a classic distraction tactic. What the Metropolitan Police are obviously concerned about is the truth of the Savile paedophile ring coming out. And I respectfully agree with Tom Watts. I'm in the Tory party, he's in Labour, but he's a good man, and I think he was speaking in good faith, and he's quite well informed. He's one of the better informed Labour MPs. Now, the problem with Jimmy Savile was that his paedophile ring was protected from within the Cabinet Office. That is because the Cabinet Secretary of the day, John Hunt, was a paedophile, and so was the Prime Minister Edward Heath. We're going back to the early 70s.
Right.
Both are now dead, of course. Now, Savile was supplying boys to, teenage boys, underage boys, to Heath and Hunt. That meant that his ring was protected. Because it was protected, Savile had lived with no fear of arrest whatsoever.
Right.
And any police force that got close to him was effectively pushed away.
Right.
Now, the problem with policing in Britain is that it was taken over centrally in 1964. The tradition of British police, Sonia, has always been that it's local, and they used to be controlled by watch committees. And these were democratically accountable committees, mostly consisting of local councillors and justices of the peace. They were local, they reported back to, they were independent. And in 1964, we had the Police Act 64, that was a disaster, because the Cabinet Office effectively took control of policing. Now, that's not how it was billed.
Right.
But there was a famous case called Ridge and Baldwin. There was a mini scandal created over a watch committee in Brighton. Some very unfair accusations were made against the chief constable down there in Sussex. There was a massive breach of procedure. It led to a famous case called Ridge and Baldwin, went to the House of Lords. Every administrative lawyer knows about it.
Right.
Classic case on natural justice. Now, once the Cabinet Office effectively took control of policing, it allowed them to influence who is arrested and who isn't.
Right.
And that situation is carried down to the present day. And I've had rows with chief constables about this, and not every chief constable agrees with it. And in practice, chief constables report to the Cabinet Office, not the Home Office, and certainly not to county councils or to their local communities.
So the two men you referred to, obviously they're dead.
Yes. Well, otherwise I couldn't refer to them. It's a shame. I mean, I wouldn't make a statement about anybody that was untrue. It's a shame that you can only expose misdeeds after people have died.
Oh, a big shame.
It's a great shame, but that is the law. And you wouldn't be allowed to broadcast, I'm well aware of living paedophiles, but you wouldn't be allowed to broadcast if I gave the names.
So are you aware of living paedophiles currently encircling Parliament?
Oh, yes. There are several in Parliament at the moment.
Right.
And they're being blackmailed.
They are being blackmailed.
And it's a problem.
And by whom would they be blackmailed?
Well, it all goes back to Germany. The German intelligence are the classic users of paedophiles.
Mm.
The Germans understand paedophilia very well. Not saying all Germans are paedophiles, but
obviously.
German intelligence have always understood paedophilia. And they've also had a good understanding of human nature and human weakness. It partly goes back to Freud, who was one of their intelligence advisors. He was one of their psychiatric advisors. The Germans have always had brothels, male brothels, in England. In the 1930s, they had three. There was one in Oxford, one in Cambridge, and one in London.
Right.
And they also had female brothels as well. And they
interesting dispersal there, really, isn't
well,
it?
Well, yes, and it's not... London is the centre of power. Oxford and Cambridge are the centres of education, or were then. And, of course, what the Germans are doing is spotting future leaders.
Right.
Edward Heath was recruited at Oxford. He was recruited at Balliol.
Right.
In 1937.
Right.
Edward Heath first met Adolf Hitler in 1937 at the Nuremberg Party Rally. And he also met Heinrich Himmler. Heinrich Himmler invited him round to drinks.
Right.
Heath was working for Canaris. Himmler tried to recruit Heath, or to get him to spy on Canaris for him, or to find out what Heinrich was up to, I don't know. But in any event, Heinrich invited Heath at a young age to this drinks party. It's quite famous in intelligence circles.
Presumably he was already aware of Heath's proclivities.
Yes, he was aware Heath was gay,
right.
And liked young men. And Heath was already being supplied with young men.
Right.
Now, one of the young men who accompanied Heath, who's still living, was British.
Right.
And Heath had a lover on that trip.
Right.
And his name is known to British intelligence.
Okay.
So I'm not going to give it, but and I wouldn't anyway. I don't want to embarrass him. Awfully nice chap.
Okay.
And I've spoken to him.
Okay. Awfully nice chap, except for being a paedophile?
This is the young man who is the boyfriend. This is the young man who is... I'm using the word boyfriend.
You. Yeah, okay. Exactly. So he's privy, he's the keeper of secrets.
Exactly. He's now in his 90s.
Fine.
We're going back 70.
Right.
We're going back to when he was a young man. So we're going back to 1937. So we're going back.
Right.
So if you think about
We're going back some way.
We're going
back to a history.
One of the nice things about... history is that you can often learn living history from people who are in their 80s and their 90s.
Right.
One of my intelligence contacts is aged 100, And I don't discount what anybody's telling me just because they're old.
Right. If you want to find out what plain fallacy is.
Well, if you want to find out what happened to the Nazi era, talk to somebody who lived.
Exactly. I mean, I'm really interested in the whole issue of sort of paedophiles in the establishment.
Yeah.
Sort of from a personal perspective, because it sort of really affects me on an inner level, you know.
Yes.
And I've written quite extensively about it and broadcast about it, and I've actually interviewed survivors.
Yes. Well, David Icke's done some good work on this too.
Indeed, but you know, one of the interesting things, I mean, it's interesting that you mentioned Heath, because actually in one of David Icke's earliest books, The Biggest Secret, he actually referred to Edward Heath on Jersey.
Yeah.
And Heath was made aware of these allegations 7 years before he died, and he did absolutely nothing about it.
They're true. There's no law, there's a common misunderstanding, there's no law against telling the truth.
Right.
You can expose. David Icke was courageous enough to expose Heath when Heath was still alive.
Right.
Took a risk, obviously.
Yes, well, big risk.
It was a big risk, but it was a fair risk because he was telling the truth.
But was it also really easy for Heath to sidestep what David Icke had said, because David had already been portrayed in a certain light anyway? We can dismiss what he's saying. Do you think that there was a degree of that?
Yes, I mean, Heath would have been advised, I imagine, A, not to sue for libel.
Right.
But, partly because what David Icke was saying was true.
Right.
It's a huge mistake. If you go to a solicitor and say, look, what this chap is saying is true,
right,
it's not libel. Any good solicitor or good barrister will tell you, don't bother suing. One of the problems with legal cases is that the truth has a nasty habit of coming out.
Right. Because, you know, the accusations against Edward Heath are shocking. I mean, when I first heard them, I was... really incredibly shocked. This whole idea that these children are being taken from Hope de la Garenne to his boat, you know, basically sodomised and all manner of awful, horrendous things happening to them. They were murdered, thrown overboard and done and dusted.
Yes.
That sounds like an accurate account to you.
Yes, that's what happened.
I mean, that is just extraordinary. And that is our former British Prime Minister.
Yes, who took us into the European Union.
Right.
Well, that's why we ended up in the European
Union.
Right,
exactly. Expand on the... Right, okay.
Now, the problem, from an intelligence perspective, and I got into the intelligence game, really in the Pinochet case, going back to the late 1990s, the problem with paedophiles, if they're politicians... If you're abusing a boy of, say, 14,
right,
and some of them are as young as 14, if you're sexually abusing a boy of 14 years old, that boy will recognise you if you're famous. Edward Heath was then leading the opposition prime minister. So the boy would know, be old enough to know who was abusing him. We had this problem with Madeleine McCann as well. Even at four, she was old enough to recognise, or would have been old enough to recognise, who was abusing it.
I mean, obviously, this is a hot potato for us. We last night had an interview from South Africa with a South African businessman by the name of Stephen Burt, who spent in excess of £50,000 on the Madeleine McCann investigation of his own accord. And it is highly controversial, obviously.
Yes.
And I know that you've talked about Madeleine McCann before within this same reference, term of reference.
Yes.
Have you not been threatened, you know, for
yes,
in any way, shape? You have been threatened. Who threatens you, Michael?
Oh, Thames Valley Police.
Okay.
There's been a whole series of incidents. My house has been raided.
Right.
The report I did on Madeleine McCann was seized from my house.
Was it?
Along with the script, along with the text of my new book, Spy Hunter, which caused some delay.
And who seized it? Thames Valley Police,
yes, on instructions of the Cabinet Office.
And you've not got it back?
Oh, I haven't got the book. I haven't got the electronic copies they seized back, but I'm not stupid. I had backed the book up, I'm sure.
Right.
There's no law against telling the truth. There's no breach of law in publishing the book.
And a barrister would know this.
Yes.
But
I did. I haven't read newspapers for libel, but I have been consulted by those barristers who do.
Right.
And I have expressed views on articles prior to publication as to whether they should go ahead or not. Just informally. So, yes, I read the book for libel as I wrote it.
Right.
I read it from a lawyer's perspective, because I knew how a lawyer would look at it when it went in front of a publisher's lawyer. So there's no problem with the book. The problem is it tells the truth, and the Cabinet Office is a bit nervous.
I mean, one of the things that strikes me about you is you speak with an absolute confidence and certainty about what you're saying.
Well, that's because it's true, and I have the sort